Hello, my name is Bojan Mitov, the president of Mitov Software, and in this session we will demonstrate developing Windows and Android applications with the cross-platform Mitov Software component libraries. Mitov Software offers wide variety of products. Of those, the following are Windows and Android compatible: Visual Live Bindings. A universal Visual Live Binding library is completely ported to Android. Logic Lab, a Boolean logic library, is completely ported to Android. And Animation Lab, universal animation library, is completely ported. Intelligence Lab, a artificial intelligence library, is practically completely ported. However, we still have to finish a little bit more work on one last component before we can declare it 100% completed. Plotlab, a data visualization library, is in process of being ported and should be available in the next couple of months as well. Currently, the rest of our products are Windows only, however, they also will slowly be ported to Android. Those are VideoLab, a video processing library, AudioLab, audio processing library, SignalLab, digital signal processing library, Vision Lab, a computer vision library, Instrument Lab, a visual instrumentation library. We also have OpenWire Studio, which is a standalone integrated graphical development environment. We'll start the introduction with Visual Live Bindings. Visual Live Bindings was the first Visual Live Binding library for Delphi ever introduced. It binds using OpenWire, an open source library also developed and maintained by Mitov Software. It can bind complex objects, it is thread safe, and it can integrate directly with all of the Mitov Software products. For our first demonstration, we'll start with a FireMonkey application. We'll drop a checkbox and a button. We'll right-click on the checkbox and select New Visual Live Bindings. Here, we'll filter to the isChecked property and we'll assign a source pin. Then, we'll do similar thing for the button. Here, we'll search for the Enable property. And we'll assign a sync pin. Now, we can switch to the OpenWire view. And we can connect the isChecked with the Enabled. We'll run the application in Windows. You can see that we can control the enabled state of the button by checking and unchecking the checkbox. We did not need to write any code for this. Now we can switch to Android and we can recompile the application again. Our application is ready to run on Android device. Since I am working from inside virtual machine, I am unable to run and demonstrate it in the Android simulator, and I am unable to show the screen of my external device. However, I can assure you that this code runs on my Nexus 7. Now let's take a look at more interesting example. In this case, we'll start with client dataset. We'll select database for it. We'll drop string grid and Navigator. Next, we will add again some visual live bindings. We'll start with the client dataset. We'll add a source pin to it. Then, for the string grid, we'll add sync pin. And for the bind navigator, we'll add another sync pin. Now we can switch to our OpenWire view and connect them. Our dataset is already connected and working with the string grid. Let's run the application. As you can see, all of the components are working properly together. Next, we'll add edit bugs. And a label. We'll add pins to both of them. For the edit box, we'll add state pin for its text property. For the label, we'll add a sync pin for the text property. Next, we'll add all the fields to the dataset. For the record number of the dataset, we'll add a source pin. Next, for the category field, we'll add a string state pin. Now we can switch to the OpenWire view and we'll connect the label to the record number, so we can see the number of the record currently selected in the dataset. For the edit, we'll connect it to the client dataset category. And we'll rearrange the components to see them better. Now let's run the application. We can see the current record being displayed on the label. We can edit the category field from the edit box or directly from inside the string grid. And our navigator still works, including cancel and confirm operations. Next, we'll do some more fun stuff. With visual live bindings, we already saw that we can add pins to components and properties and then make connections between them. Those components and properties are not limited only to the components on the form, but we can access any public or published property on the form itself. So let's add pin for the caption of the form. And we'll connect it to the species name. We also will add a couple of more pins. The length in inches, we'll add a state pin. And for the width of the edit one, we'll add a sync pin. Now, in the OpenWR diagram, we'll connect the caption to the species name. And the width of the edit box to the length in inches. Let's see it running. You can see that our edit box is changing its width based on which element in the database is selected. And we can see also that the caption of the form is changing accordingly. Let's add some more interesting elements to the form. We will add a T image and 3D viewport. Next, we'll add round cube in the viewport. We'll add light. And light material source. We'll arrange the components. We'll select material source for the cube. Then we'll add OpenWR pins. For the bitmap of the image 1, we'll add stream persist sync pin as well as for the light material source. For the graphic field, we'll add stream persist source pin. We'll switch to the OpenWR view and we'll connect them. Let's run the application. You can see that the graphic field is used to populate both components. To make it more interesting, next we'll add pin to the width property of the round cube as well. And we'll connect it to the length in inches. Let's run the application. You can see that everything is working properly, including setting the width of the round cube. So far, we demonstrated linking properties and components with the OpenWR pins. The OpenWR Visual Live binding, however, allows not only that, but also adding pins to events and any public method, as well as linking them. Let's try that. We'll add two buttons. And we will add pins to their onclick event. Then we'll add pins to the next and previous method of the client dataset. And we'll connect them with OpenWire. Let's run the application. Now we can navigate our database with our newly added buttons, so we can handle events without the need to write any code. This is not all. There is vast amount of other functionalities in the Mitov software's visual live bindings, simply not available in any other live binding product whatsoever. However, we'll display some of the most useful ones. Sometimes we want to use a list box and display all of the elements of a particular field. Let's do that. We'll add list box. And we'll add visual live binding for it. We'll go to the items of the list box and we'll set a sync pin. Next, we'll select the common name field and we'll add tstrings source pin. And we'll connect them. Let's run the application. Here are all of the records for the common name field. All of this up to this point was demonstrated on Windows. Let's see if we can compile it for Android. You can see that the build went successfully, and now we can run the same application on Android. In addition to all this, we can link our database with the rest of our other products. Since they are not fully ported to Android yet, we will do this in Windows. We will drop a scope component. Then we'll add OpenWrap in. To the length in centimeters field of type ReoList. Now we can go to the OpenWire and connect this field with one of the channels of the scope. Now the scope is connected to the field. Let's run the application. You can see that the scope is properly populated with the values from the field. In our next demo, we'll demonstrate direct linking between VideoLab and Visual Live bindings. We'll start with a video player. And we'll add a viewport. In the viewport round cube, like and like material. Next, we'll select video to play in the video player. And we'll open the Visual Live Bindings editor. And we'll add Stream Persist to the light material source. Now we'll switch to the OpenWire editor and we'll connect the video to the light material source. Let's run the application. You can see the video playing as texture of the cube. We can even add rotation to the cube. We'll add a sync pin for the Z rotation angle. And we'll connect this pin to the progress. Let's run it. You can see our cube rotating as the video progresses. Using VideoLab with Visual Live bindings surely is a lot of fun. Next, we'll demonstrate Animation Lab. Animation Lab can animate any property through the Visual Live bindings. It can be used to animate both visual and non-visual components. It contains timeline and simple physics engine. Again, we'll start with a FireMonkey application. We'll drop timeline. And we'll open the timeline editor. Next, we'll add a couple of channels to that timeline. We'll add two real channels. We can also add integer channel, but we'll not demonstrate this in the current demo. With Animation Lab, you can have many channels with different types, such as real integers, and we are working to add color and other types. Each of the channels has periods. We can edit those periods. Currently, we can add only linear interpolation periods. We are, however, working to add other forms of interpolation. So let's add a couple of periods to the first channel. Then we'll select the second channel and we'll add a couple of periods. Let's do three periods for this one. Let's extend the length of this period to 1.5 seconds. This is the interval in seconds. Let's select the first period and set the value to 20. Then select the channel and set the initial value to 100. Finally, for the second period, let's set the value to 200. Select the second channel and set some initial value. Then select the first interval and set another value. Second interval, another value. And for the last interval, another value. Here we have two channels in our animation sequence. Next, let's connect those channels to some properties. For this, we'll drop a button. And we'll add couple of pins to it using visual live bindings. For the X and Y position. And we'll connect the button to the timeline. We'll set the timeline to loop, and since it is enabled, the animation will start as soon as we start the application. Let's run it. You can see that our button is animated. Now let's disable the animation and add pins to its start event and the on-click event of the button. Now we'll connect them. Let's run the application. If I click my button, the animation sequence will start. It is set to loop, so it will go indefinitely. Let's disable the loop and run again. You can see that our animation starts as soon as we click the button. Next, we'll add some physics effect. We'll add mass to the bottom. We'll add the mass in the x-axis. Now our button has a mass and thus inertia. We can also add mass to the y-axis, or we can add drag to it. Now, the component has drag on the y-axis and mass on the x-axis. Equally easy, we can animate three-dimensional objects. We can add a viewport. And round cube in it. Light source, and some light material. Then we can select one of the rotation axes and add pin to it. Then we can connect it to one of the channels. You can see that the cube gets animated. We can also connect it after the mask has been applied. Or, if we wanted, we could have added it its own type of mass. You can see that the mass effect is working. All this also works in Android. We can come here and change the target to Android, then build it for Android. You can see that it builds just fine, and it will run. This concludes our session. My name again is Bojan Mitov, the president of Mitov Software. You can see my email here, mitov@mitov.com. Our website is www.mitov.com. We offer a wide range of products, including VideoLab, video processing library, AudioLab, audio processing library, SignalLab, digital signal processing library, VisionLab, computer vision library, PlotLab, data visualization library, InstrumentLab, visual instrumentation library, IntelligenceLab, artificial intelligence library. We are nearing the release of Logic Lab, Boolean Logic Library, Animation Lab, Universal Animation Library. We also offer Visual Live Binding, Universal Visual Live Binding Library, and OpenWire Studio, a standalone graphical development environment. We also maintain two open source libraries, the OpenWire Library and the iGDI Plus library, a Delphi-friendly GDI Plus library. Thank you for listening, and now it's time for questions and answers.
that, and it was initially designed as a text parsing tool. Actually, I was working on preprocessors and coparsing, and I started it as a simple tool to allow me to easily design and parse code as part of bigger project. And then I came with the concept, basically, which nowadays had evolved in binding about around that time, and started promoting a technology which allowed property to be connected to another property in essence. So it's a precursor effectively to the what nowadays is available in other platforms as data binding. And then since then it had evolved through many years and many iterations. Eventually we added a graphical development, and I mean graphical editor, which again is developed by me. We added the ability to have visualized binding to any other property, so not only to have pins which are predefined as a special type of properties into the components, but now you can create such injected per se property at design time and add as many pins as you want to a component and bind them to specific properties, events or methods of the component, and then do the connections. And all of this is fully multi-threaded. All of our libraries are based on this functionality. It's very high performance, as all of our libraries probably have demonstrated over the years, and the possibilities where this thing can go are pretty much limitless. We are about to release few more libraries, which are kind of entering the final stages. Logic Lab will be released in the next month or two. Animation Lab is going to be released at about the same time. There are a couple of other libraries that are going to be released a couple of months later. So that's all I can say. I mean,
okay, and you had answered some questions earlier. Ralph asked, are Audio Lab and Video Lab on your roadmap for Android?
Yes, all of our products will be fully cross-platform. However, some of those products have been developed over 10 years, and porting them is not as easy as others. I mean, all of the new development we do, like Logic Lab, Animation Lab, including the Visual Live Binding, is already cross-platform. The rest, Plot Lab, is almost complete. Completed in terms of transition. Signal Lab is now, say, about 60-70% already done. Audio Lab and Video Lab, they're at around 15-20% done at the moment, and it's going to be a few more months before they're fully ported. Intelligence Lab, oddly enough, is practically 100% ported. There are a few lines of code, literally, which we need to work out to decouple it from Windows, and it will be done. So yeah, everything within about a year from now, practically everything will be cross-platform.
Sandro asked.
Pardon me?
Go ahead.
Yeah, some things in the next couple of months, some things are going to be up to a year.
Okay. Sandro asked, is it possible to recognize license plates or other images or lettering, convert letters and numbers from camera in real time, like OCR, using some of your components?
Yes, I answered that question. Intelligence, there are actually multiple ways this can be done. Intelligence Lab is particularly suitable for this task. It has classifiers. They can be trained to recognize practically anything. We have a demo where they are trained to recognize faces of different people and distinguish between those people. This demo is very easy to modify to train to recognize characters instead of people. So just modifying this demo is pretty much enough to have OCR available.
And then Ralph asked, for Video Lab, what video formats does it support?
Well, it supports currently, it can play any file for which you have DirectShow codec on your system, as long as the codec is not protected, and very few codecs hopefully are protected. Those are specifically MP2 codecs, which are protected in order to prevent copyright issues with DVDs, since MP2 is usually used for DVDs. Other than that, practically any video format for which you have DirectShow codec will be played. The library for processing supports about, I forgot the exact number, but around 10 internal video formats. Those are pixel formats. In terms of recording, the same thing. Since recording and playback are done with codecs, the same rule applies. Any codec you have, practically, you can record into it. And the same thing for capturing device. Practically any DirectShow device you can capture, or any DirectShow external renderer you can render on it. In addition, we are adding support for FFmpeg internally for the next version of the library, and that will open full out-of-the-box support for any codec supported by FFmpeg, which covers almost any feasible video format.
Yeah, that's a lot. It's every converter tool I
practically
use, almost all of them support FFmpeg. Does Audiolab have the same wide range? This isn't a question, but it sort of ties into this. Audiolab has the same thing. It supports all sorts of audio formats.
Yeah, the same, absolutely the same applies. The libraries are done the same way. So the answer applies for that one. We are adding FFmpeg for that one as well. So.
And then there was a question earlier about for OpenWire and bindings. If I've got database components or a client data set, can I use it there?
Yeah, the answer is yes, since we are binding directly to any descendant from T dataset. So anything which inherits from T dataset in any way will support.
Okay. Then there was a question about cloud connectivity, like Amazon Web Services or Azure. Is there anything to hook into, like, cloud storage, I guess it looks like? Yeah, between the lines there, yeah.
Yeah, at the moment, the only way you can hook to that I'm aware of is if you have any, again, T data set descendant component that maps into that service. You can live bind into it. We are, however, actually, but that's again under development, we are working to implement remote visual live binding in essence, effectively. So you will be able to do remote binding to web services and things like that, as well as remote binding visually two applications together with visual live binding. So that is not fully available yet, but a lot of work already is done in this direction. So in the next 4 or 5 months, it could very well be a reality.
Yeah, Giovanni, I guess I would chime in, but I wanted to be careful. It's always good to see videos of Xena in your demonstration.
Well, I already answered, always the warrior.
Yep, there you go. Elazar was asking, you had talked earlier about things like face recognition and such. He was wondering about objects in general. I guess, what if you train the intelligence lab to look for apples or watch faces or whatever?
Yeah, I already answered that question for the OCR, but yes, the classifiers are universal. They don't care what they what you're training them for. They don't care what they are recognizing. All they care is whatever you train them for, that's what they're going to recognize. If you train them for apples you will recognize. If you train them for human faces, well, human faces. Also, I mean, characters, whatever you train.
Yeah, Ralph asks about MPEG Dash.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with MPEG Dash quite frankly, but again, the answer is that any codec, any direct show, as a matter of fact, not only direct show, we also support the older video for Windows. Any codec you have pretty much on your system, it will be able to decode and encode to and from it. So that means most likely the answer is yes.
Got it. Okay. Let's see. Ralph is asking, he wasn't sure if it's appropriate, but what the heck, we got a couple minutes. Spend a moment about your business model and pricing, purchasing, you know, all of that detail there.
Sure. Yeah, I can describe that, no problem. So when you buy our products, you get 1 year of free upgrades to any new version, and whatever you buy is not time limited. I mean, you can use it forever. After that 1 year expires, if you want currently to upgrade, we offer not to upgrade, but to basically renew your upgrade policy. You can renew for another 1 year for 50% of the price of the product at the time of the renewal. We also offer In addition to our libraries, we have the new graphical development environment, which is in beta at the moment, which is intended for non-developers to be able to visually, in essence, create applications. We offer all of the functionality that is available in the OpenWire Studio for embedding under special licensing terms to some of our partners, and we are working with some companies to do that. We also are obviously doing some contract services, usually related with our technologies or expansions of our technologies. So, I mean, we do that as well. That's probably a rough description of our business model and licensing terms. I hope it was helpful.
Yep. And Ralph just says MPEG Dash is the new Microsoft IBM set media direction. Please check into it. Okay.
Yeah, I will check. But again, as I said, Microsoft provides codecs for their video formats, including ASF. So the answer then is automatically yes. I was thinking something to add to one of the other questions and got a little bit sidetracked.
Yeah, I think you covered most of it.
One more thing I wanted to add to the licensing terms. There are no royalties for the products. So that's typical question. Once when you buy license, the license is per developer. So once when you develop anything with our products, you can sell it. There are no additional fees or anything.
Great. Thanks, Boyan. And thanks a lot, Boyan. I'm just going to finish up couple things real quick. Thanks again, Boyan.
Thank you very much, guys.
Yep.
Thanks.